They call me Jennergy because I've got that joyful energy from my Father God above. But it's not just for me. He will shower you with love and from your burden set you free, give you peace that makes no sense and a whole lot of Jennergy.
Hi, welcome back to the Jennergy for Life podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Jen. With me, my co-host, Ashley Hillsman.
Hello.
And then back there on the mic, running production, Trent Denson from Spread the Positive. We have another great episode today. We have actually prayed about this one all week, which is rare for us. Usually we roll in and we say, all right, Holy Spirit, what do you want us to talk about today? But this is really a message that has been laid on our heart all week, which is kind of fun because we got to ruminate on it and think about it prayerfully all week. So today's topic is He has good plans for you and He is sovereign in it all. And it's really important to remember that even though the plans are good and He wants you to prosper, it doesn't mean that every step of it is going to be without struggle. There's still going to be trials in this fallen, broken world, but it's important to remember that at the end of the day, He loves you and He has good plans for you. So Ashley's going to read us the scripture that talks about this.
Yeah, so our scripture today is Jeremiah 29. We're going to start at verse 10. And I'll read through 12. For thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me and I will hear you.
So there's a lot of really good news in this. Yeah. First of all, the fact that the Lord has promised good plans and hope, and that if you cry out to Him, He will hear you.
Yeah.
Like, let's pause on that for a minute,
because yeah, I really like
that is some really good. So we're starting with the good news first, right?
Yeah.
So it's really encouraging to know that we have a God who hears you. I think a lot of times people who maybe aren't believers or who are very green in their walk sometimes feel like, well, yeah, I believe in God, but He's far off in heaven and He doesn't pay any attention to us because we have free will. And free will doesn't mean God isn't involved. He wants us to use our free will. He says it right there. Call out to me and I'll hear you. Mm-hmm. He wants to be involved. He wants us to surrender our free will and to partner with Him so that those good plans happen sooner, right? Because we don't necessarily get to pick the timing on this.
Right.
So do you have anything to add to that?
Well, I was just going to like give some context to the scripture that we just read, because some people may not be super familiar with like the backdrop of what's happening here. Not that I'm super familiar. I had
right.
to do some
what is Babylon?
I had to do,
right?
Yeah,
no,
that's
you don't have
not,
to go there.
I was gonna say, I don't know. I had to do some research, which for me means Googling. But I know that 29:11 is a very like famous scripture. I feel like it's one that we've heard like a lot. But like the context here is that like Israel is being exiled from the promised land. I think they're being exiled from Jerusalem. They've been captured by the Babylonians. And so it's actually like a very like hard time, especially because a false prophet did come and like, I mean, he said that.
Made some grand promises.
Can we like compare it to maybe like the false prosperity gospel that we hear a lot here in our current culture, where he was like, you're going to be delivered from the Babylonians and they're going to be defeated. And it was like, actually, you're going to lose this particular battle. But the Lord was promising them that He would not forget about them. He said, when 70 years are completed, I will visit you and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. And a little bit before then, He was telling them like, you're going to be exiled, but that doesn't mean that you can put up your walls and like do nothing. And it doesn't mean that you should like succumb to the hardships of the situation. But He was telling them like to like verse 6 above what I just read, same chapter, says take wives and have sons and daughters and take wives and multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city. And so He was saying, like, you still need to live your life.
Right.
You still need to, like, you know,
bloom where
plant
you planted.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was it.
Yeah.
And I think we can, like, grasp from that when we're having our own like hardships and different things. It's not that we can like bury ourselves and have like our own personal pity party forever until it's over.
Right,
but it's
while we're
like
waiting on those promises.
Yeah, yeah. But it's like, okay, Lord, like what am I supposed to do where I'm at right now?
Right. In this season. Yeah. And even, you know, I've mentioned this a couple times, you know, my deep longing to be a mom. And it feels like, you know, it's been 5 years. That is a painful season of waiting. You know, we've talked about, we've all got some things we're waiting on. And I feel that because he gives us the desires of our hearts, I know he put that desire there. Right. And I know that he will come through. Right. And I know that he has good plans for me.
Right.
But that doesn't mean it's tomorrow.
Right.
Right. And yeah. And the false prophet in that that you're referencing had said, you know, it'll be soon. It'll be in what, 2 years or something like yeah. that. Mm-hmm. And turns out, no, it's actually going to be 70 years yeah. that you have to wait. And Lord, I hope I don't have to wait 70 years to be a mom.
Right.
But my point with that is the plans are still good, but that doesn't mean they're tomorrow. And it doesn't mean it's not this instant gratification, right? And you had mentioned prosperity gospel. And I think where it gets tricky is that, you know, all of that is rooted in the Lord wants you to prosper. All mm-hmm. of that is true. It's mm-hmm. the instant gratification, I think, where people sometimes take it too far. And the emphasis being on the promise versus the promise maker. We should always be desiring God more than the desire, more
right.
than the promise that he's made us.
Right.
So even recognizing this encouraging, uplifting scripture that says he has good plans for you.
Yeah.
Yay, celebrate.
Yeah.
But don't focus on those plans.
Right.
Don't be more excited about the plans
right.
than you are the planner,
yeah.
right? It should always be him that we're focusing on.
Mm-hmm.
And we can be encouraged that he has good plans for us.
Right.
But don't be so wrapped up in those plans that you forget that your eyes should be on Christ instead.
Yeah. Because before we had press record, we were kind of talking about that. And it's like having your eyes on the Lord will keep you from being too puffed up when you're on the mountaintop, right? Where you don't get all prideful. And it's like now that you've gotten what you wanted, you're like, I don't need you, God, anymore. And having your eyes on the Lord in the valley keeps you from being like buried under your trials, where it's like, I'll never make it out of these hardships, you know, like woe is me, this is just all my life will be. But like if you can just keep your eyes on the Lord, like you will have grace, you'll be graced for whatever season you find yourself in. And it is on my heart to encourage people to pray to God and ask him, Lord, define prosperity for me. Like, what do you mean by prosperity? Because sometimes people think it means like a life with no trials and no
right.
hardships. And I just I challenge you to maybe open your mind to a different idea of what prosperity can look like, you know,
mm-hmm.
Because the Lord did say that in this world we will have troubles, but take heart, I have overcome the world. And through my own life, I have learned, like, as much as I don't really like the hardships and the trials and the struggles that we have, that is when the Lord's light shines the brightest in my life. You know, it's when it's during darker times that his light shines brighter. And so I think we do ourselves a disservice when we want to rush through every trial. That's not to say that we want to, that's not to say we want to pray for him. That's not to say we want to, you know, ask, you know, for hardships necessarily. But I think that it can be very beautiful and very eye-opening and very just life-giving when you do find yourself in a trial to ask the Lord, okay, like, what does prosperity look like here? Like, what has this come into my life for, and what can I learn from it, you know? And I think those are prayers that he, like, runs to answer. So you'll definitely get an answer. And I think you'll come out stronger on the other side of it, too.
And also on that same note, how can I grow closer to you
right.
from this? Because that's what he wants. Like any good parent, he wants a relationship with us. And I don't ever think that God causes bad things to happen in our life. But I do think because he's sovereign, sometimes things are allowed to happen and he doesn't immediately swoop us out of it because he does want us to lean in on him. And that's not to say that, you know, if something bad happens to you, you weren't leaning into God close enough. It's not that simple. We live
right.
in a very complicated world. And even though God is sovereign over all of it, it's still a fallen, broken world. And sometimes the enemy throws things at you. Other people's free will can get in the way. But when you get into those seasons, it's when we hit rock bottom that we start looking up and reaching out to God. You know, that's from that song, Matthew West, Strong Enough. And that mm-hmm. song hit me the first time I heard it. It hit me so hard because I was in a low place, and it reminded me, even though a relationship with God doesn't change the circumstances, allowing him into, like you said, those dark places and letting his light shine in those places changes your heart. Yeah. The circumstances are going to be what they're going to be a lot of times. And he'll deliver you sometimes. But a lot of times it's more about what he's doing in your heart anyway.
Right.
And so, like you said, we can learn to be grateful for those trials, because changing of the heart posture is really what gets you through this race of life with a grace and endurance and a peace that we all really want, right? Yeah. You know, it's like you said, prosperity is not just having it be sunshine and rainbows all the time. It's having your heart have a sense of peace and calm, even in the middle of the storm, like Jesus taking a nap in the boat.
Yeah, and I know we were also talking a little bit about like divine appointments earlier this week too. And
because that's part of his plans for you.
I was gonna say it's part of his plans for us, but then also I've been learning in a way, and this is probably common sense to a lot of people, but like how the kingdom of heaven comes to earth a lot of times is through us, the body of Christ. Like, we're filled with the Holy Spirit, and the Lord has plans for us, right? Plans that are prepared ahead of time. That's like Ephesians 2:10, I think. And so maybe we're in a season that we don't want to be in, or a circumstance that we don't necessarily want to be in. But maybe if we can take our eyes off of the circumstances, and maybe even off of how we're feeling about it and ourselves in it, but we can look around and say, Lord, am I here for someone else? Maybe like, am I here so someone else can have some seeds planted, or maybe their eyes like opened or hear like from a God perspective, this situation. I think about how he told them to like the Israelites in Babylon to like get married and have sons and daughters and like multiply there. And it's like, it's because he had work for them to do there. I don't know. The Bible doesn't necessarily go into details, I don't think, of what happened in those 70 years while they were there. But who knows if who knows if maybe the Lord's name was made known there because of their time there, you know? And so like, maybe you're at a job that you don't want to be in. I'm talking about myself. You have hopes for something else in the future, but maybe the Lord has you where he has you, not because that's the job that you were made to do, but for another reason, to maybe point someone else to Christ, or just like be a light in that place, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, you never know what the Lord's up to.
Yeah. I mean, how we met was a divine appointment. That was exactly what you said. You know, that wasn't your dream job, being a receptionist at a medical
center,
you know. And while I was very happy in doing the physical therapy work, I wanted to own my own practice. I wanted to do other things.
Yeah.
And so neither of us really saw that as, oh, this is where I'm going. This is my forever home. Right.
Yeah.
But think about all the things that God orchestrated, right? He loves us enough that he cares about every hair on our head, right?
Yeah.
So think about everything that he lined up in order for us to meet together. I was joking with you the other day. We had done a special kids race, and we were both, how was everybody else that worked there so incredibly fit but us? And we were both lagging behind, significantly, and we turned around. But that built a relationship and a rapport to the point where it was on my mind and heart because of that.
Yeah.
That's where our friendship blossomed, was us both kind of being out of shape, you know. And I'd love to blame it on the fact that my dinosaur costume was inflating, but it wasn't. I was tired, and I think, like you mentioned, my hips were hurting. So we were both turned around, and we bonded over that.
Yeah.
And because of that, that led me to be perceptive to hearing the Holy Spirit say, she needs to go to lunch with Jack. And that changed your life, and that changed our friendship.
It did indeed.
And how I met Jack was a divine appointment from when we were, you know, as LT360 then, and he came in and I saw his name on the schedule and accosted him in the in the lobby and was like, "Hi, I'm Levi's wife." And he just thought that was so funny.
Yep.
Invites us to lunch. Levi barely knew him. They worked together but didn't know each other.
Yeah.
And that one lunch, I mean, I've talked about it several times. I got an eyeball transplant, started to see the
changed everything,
metaphorically,
right?
An eyeball transplant, but saw the Lord everywhere. Mm-hmm. That was literally the moment that woke me up and caught me on fire. And so, you know, even though it wasn't the end all be all, like, those moments were used by the Lord, divinely connected, because it's part of the plans he had for us. So I'm grateful for every single job that I've had, every single detour down the road, because the Lord uses it all. And we also mentioned Jonah. This is one of my favorite stories to think about too. Even though the Lord told Jonah, you need to go to Nineveh, and Jonah was a little bratty and said, no, I'm not going to, ends up in the belly of the whale, still ends up at Nineveh. So even if you don't hear it right, or you choose to go down a different path, the Lord is still sovereign. He's still going to give you opportunities to get back in his will for your life. And he's going to keep orchestrating plans and these divine appointments like we've talked about. And I'm pretty sure even how I met Trent was a divine appointment. You know, me meeting Jessica and her saying, you know, I know who you would really connect well with, my buddy who is Spread the Positive, and you're very positive
yourself.
So like, look back on all those times, on all those moments you wouldn't have thought twice about, oh, I'm going to a networking event and I'm going to meet one of my closest friends and end up on a podcast with my best friend. Yeah. Like, what? God did all of that.
Yeah.
And you remember what you told me when we were talking about it? It was so good. I'm glad I remember it. but you said, and it was less about what we do in all of it. God planned all those things out. So stop worrying about making the right decision, showing up to the right coffee shop at the right time, because it wasn't about what you did anyway.
Exactly.
God orchestrated all of those things. And even if you messed it up, you're still going to end up where God wanted you either way. He won't take your free will, but he is sovereign over it all. Oh. He's going to continue to reach his hand out to you and push people and things and ideas your direction, because he loves you and he's never going to stop pursuing you and giving you good plans.
Yeah. So I didn't remember saying that, but I was about to say it again. So
say it again. We need to hear it again. Say it from your words. Go on.
No, I mean, I was just going to say, like, the sovereignty of God brings me a lot of rest and it gives me a lot of peace. Because I know no matter how dark the future may seem, like, I don't know how I'm supposed to get to where I'm hoping I get to. I know that he knows, you know, and I know that, like, sometimes it takes looking backwards. And I think we talk about this like every week, but sometimes it takes looking backwards to see how the Lord has, like, lined up all these things in your life. And it's like, I didn't do anything. Like, I think of, like, Blormbella, and, like, my plan was to work there while I was in school to be a travel sonographer. And I was supposed to graduate in like a year or two, maybe three, and quit and then be a travel sonographer. And it's been roughly 3 years since I would have started that job, and guess who's not a travel sonographer? But guess who's also so grateful that my plans didn't work out like how I wanted them to. I had such a narrow sight and was very myopic and couldn't even fathom the good things that God could do and would do in my life. And I was gonna say if I just let him, but the thing is, like, this is the goodness and grace and mercy of God, was that my eyes weren't even really on him like that when I first started that job, but still he went ahead and, like, laid the path for my salvation and for my relationship with him to just blossom and grow. And it's like, that's ultimately what he wants for all of us, you know? It is a matter of letting him surrender, right? It is a matter of saying, okay, Lord, I want your will to be done in my life. Like, guide my steps. Like, I need you to, like, lead me by your spirit. But, like, once we surrender to him, it's like all your plans, like, take them. Like, I don't even know what I want to do with my life. You tell me, you know, what I want. And I don't know. It's just very good. So I pulled this up. I know you're probably like, why does she have her phone out? Were you wondering? Oh, okay. Yeah. So, like, I'm going to start this by saying, like, fact check me, but, like, my family and I had done, like, we said we were going to, we kind of fell off a little bit, but we were supposed to, like, discuss a scripture as a family, like, for a week, like, meditate on it together and, like, blah, blah. I think we did it once. It was only one time. I think it was this verse was the only one, but it was 29:11, and I had been, like, Googling, and, like, this was back when I was, like, really interested in trying to figure out, like, what was the original, like, Hebrew use and, like, this, that, and the other. And this is why I say fact check me. But I learned that, because some translations, does ours say hope in a future? Does it use the word hope?
I know the one on my wall says hope. And a hope for a future.
Yeah, so it does say hope. So back in whatever year this was, when I was doing my little research, I learned, and I cannot say the Hebrew word for hope, and I'm not going to try to right now, but the particular Hebrew word for hope, at least in the translation that I found and how I researched it, means cord in this scripture. And it was the only way that it's been, that particular word, let me just read it. Sorry, I'm trying to, like, summarize it. I only saw it used to mean cord in two verses, once in Joshua 2:18 and then in 21. But I thought it was interesting how it read, if you replace hope with a cord, for a second in our verse, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, plans to give you a cord in a future. And that was really powerful to me, because I think we all know that everything in the Bible, New and Old Testament, points back to Jesus. And I feel that at least in part of what God was saying through Jeremiah was that he has a plan for a cord, a lifeline for us to have, because he saw that we couldn't do it on our own. He was telling us that a savior was on the way, and that through him we would have hope and peace until the end, no matter what our circumstances look like. And that was telling my family, like, the background of what was going on in that situation. And so, like, this is what I meant by, like, expand your mind to other definitions of prosperity than what the human mind maybe would think of when we think of prosperity, which is, like, wealth and health. And I'm not saying that the Lord does not want those things for you.
Right.
I'm not saying that. But sometimes I think it's bigger than that, you know? And I feel like no matter what your current situation may be right now, like, the ultimate prosperity that we're going to have is eternity with him. Like, that is something that I feel like the Lord's been, like, really trying to teach me right now, is, like, all these hopes and dreams that I have, as good as they are and as much as I still desire them, he's like, they are, one, temporary, and they pale in comparison to the true prosperity of eternity with him, right? Where there would be no more weeping and no more crying, where no one will get sick and no one will die, like, anymore. Like, it's just going to be good things. And so maybe if it's been trial after trial after trial, and you're just like, I don't even know what to hope for anymore, like, remember the hope of heaven. Like, remember the hope of things eternal. And I would encourage anyone that feels, like, hopeless, basically, like, we're reading the scripture 29:11, and it's like, well, God must have meant everyone but me. Just ask him to show you and help you to set your eyes on the things that are eternal and to see the good things that he has for you even in this day. And sometimes it's like the fact that we have life in our body. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes it's the fact that we were able to get out of bed this morning, that we need to cling to in particularly hard seasons. But I guess what I'm saying is, like, because I know God is so real, and like Jen was saying, like, sometimes when you're new in your walk, or depending on where you are, he can feel so distant and so far away, like he can't see you and he can't hear you and he doesn't care. But it is, like, literally the exact opposite. And so if you just, like, will invite him into whatever situation you're in, talk to him like a friend, he will enlighten the eyes of your heart. That's one of our Ephesian scriptures that we're studying in my Bible study, but I really like it. He will enlighten the eyes of your heart and give you knowledge and understanding of the things that we are to hope for. And so, yeah.
I love that. And when you say, I want to ask you a little bit more about the cord. So is that saying a cord for the future, as in, like, a tether, like a connection?
That's how
I
was reading it.
Okay.
Like a tether.
Yeah.
Like when I was first learning, and I think I butchered that. Maybe I can try to somehow, like,
give you that note in another way, because I was trying to summarize it quickly because it's kind of long. But that's how I was like envisioning it when I was learning about it. And when we started talking, I remembered it. And that's how I picture it. It's like a lifeline.
Yeah.
Almost. Yeah. Kind of like maybe the waves are rocking and it feels like our heads are going to go under. Mm-hmm. But then like Jesus is that lifeline, that rope, that cord to like hang on to, so that we're not like overcome by the storm, and we're not like taken under by the waves, you know?
Yeah.
Like that's how I.
So remembering that even when you're in the storm, that there is a future.
Yes.
And even back to that original text, the Jeremiah 29:10, really, where it's talking about it's going to be 70 years, not 2 years, right? Remembering that when we hear words like future or soon, that God's perspective of time are different. Mm-hmm. So you can have hope that you are tethered to the future he has made for you, but don't be wrapped up in the time of that, right? Because God's coming from a perspective of eternity. And like you said, that's really the future that we should be the most excited about.
Right.
So I like to picture, like you said, tethered to or lifelined, right?
Yeah.
To the heaven future.
Yeah.
And it makes it a lot easier to get through these temporary trials.
Yeah.
You know, and you hear people say life is short, and it doesn't always feel that way. Sometimes it feels like
long.
Long and long. Challenging, and lots of, you know, trial after trial, and there's sickness and sadness and darkness all around us.
Yeah.
But we do have a cord or a lifeline, like you said, to eternity with the Father. Yeah. And if you can't find anything else to be hopeful for that.
For
that
sure.
The trials of this earth are temporary.
Yeah.
And we don't have to suffer. We don't have to. Even if we're physically suffering, we don't have to feel that suffering so deeply because of that cord tethered to the Lord, right? He can give us
a peace that surpasses all understanding.
And you asked about, you know, praying what prosperity looks like. And when you said that, you know, I prayed that prayer. And for me, what I felt God say is the fruits of the Spirit.
Yeah.
Right? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Were you hearing the song too?
Yeah. Well, the song you always sing.
That I always sing. Yeah. But that's it. Right? We want joy abundant. We want peace that passes understanding. We want to live in the faithfulness of God. We want to live under his mercy and grace and extend it to others.
Yes.
And so for me, I'm a very visual person. So like when I think of prosperity, I picture the fruits of the Spirit like abundantly all around me, but I also picture like actual fruits because that's who I am. So I picture like an orange that is joy.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's it. It's those promises that come along with the Holy Spirit. And even I just got kind of like a little vision of like a jar, right? Because we have the Holy Spirit in us, and it's not like you get a little Holy Spirit, you get a little more. Once you are a born-again believer and follower of Christ, you have all the Holy Spirit you're ever going to have. Mm-hmm. He is in there, but you can jar him up, and you can only let a little bit of him out. And I think prosperity for me, the fruits of the Spirit come with the Holy Spirit, right? Mm-hmm. And so prosperity for me is taking the lid off of that jar and letting all of the Holy Spirit come through, because he's there one way or another. It's just how much do you lift the lid a little bit, let a little bit of a little joy here, maybe a little love here, but you're keeping the peace and patience wrapped tight down in. So for me, prosperity is living in the fruits of the Spirit with the Holy Spirit guiding every step, leading you towards those plans that he has for you to prosper and to fully feel all of those fruits of the Spirit that he has for us.
And I've heard that before too, about like you're going to get all the Holy Spirit that, like, once you accept Jesus Christ, like, you get the Holy Spirit. It's not like you get a little bit and then a couple more weeks you get another little bit. But I have found myself praying, and it may not be just like theologically sound, but like I've heard this like analogy, or how it's said that like we pour ourselves out to the people around us, and so like we're emptied, not that we literally are, but like in the mornings, I'm like, okay, Lord, like refill me, like give me a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit so that I can go forth and I mean, it's not like I don't think I get more, just like I don't necessarily think I lost them.
You get more awareness.
But it's like, yeah, like refresh me, like refresh my soul, like give me the eyes and the wisdom and everything that I need for this day is essentially what I'm praying. But I do love that analogy of like taking the lid off. Because yes. I do think I am someone who is like, is the word trepidation the one I'm trying to use? Like I live life with a little bit of trepidation, a little hesitancy.
Okay.
Because I like to see what's going on before I even put my foot in the water. Yeah. And then I'm going to like, is it warm? Is it cold?
Cautious and calculated.
Yeah. I'm like, But like, I love you because you're like.
Belly flopping into yes. the deep end.
Like you like running start, no hesitation, like cannonball. And I'm like watching. I'm like, did she make it? Okay. All right. I think I can go now.
I did a trust fall on poor Levi the other day without warning him. I just
did
said
he catch
trust
you?
Fall. No, because he didn't say trust fall. I did. So I dove when nobody asked me to. It's fine. The floor caught me. Carry on.
Yeah. But I was just saying, like, this is one of the things that I love about you and our friendship is because you are very much like, take the lid off. Let's go. And it like encourages me to be like, okay, my armpits are sweaty and my knees are shaking, but okay, we can take the lid off. We can do it. And it's like, it's only good things because it's God. Like, he's not going to drop. Unlike poor Levi, who just wasn't quite ready. God is ready. Arms wide open. He's not going to let you fall. And so, that was just really good. Everything you just said. And then one more thing I wanted to touch on when you were talking about how long things can take sometimes. Yeah, I get lost in that sometimes.
Me too. Like, we want the instant.
It's been forever, God. Are you sure you didn't? Did you change your mind on me? No. Okay. But I think this is why the Lord tells us to worry about today, because tomorrow's got its own problems. Mm-hmm. And so, like, one of the things I feel like he's always telling me, or at least bringing back to my remembrance, is focus on what's in front of you. Mm-hmm. Trusting that I am ahead of you, making a way. And it's like, I get myself all worked up, stressed out. Then I start feeling hopeless, overwhelmed, all the bad things. The opposite of the fruit of the Spirit, mm-hmm. because I'm thinking ahead of him. And I'm trying to figure out, like, from where I'm standing, how am I supposed to get there? And this, that, and the other. And it's like, he always just reminds me, like, you're supposed to be worried about today. Because all you got is today. Like, tomorrow for you, not even promised. Okay, so worry about the day that you're in. And I find that when I do that, it is a lot easier for me to stay in that peace and in that joy and in that contentment, because I don't think our human minds were really built with the capacity to handle, you know what I'm saying, that much into the future. That's why a lot of us have anxiety and depression and all these things. Because I think we're trying to carry a load by ourselves that we weren't quite built to carry. Does that make sense? Not to shame anybody with anxiety or depression, things I struggle with myself. But I'm just speaking to the fact that I don't know that we were made to have to strive by our own strength, because we are called to rest in him. And so focusing on the day that we're in and trusting him with tomorrow, and remembering that whatever is happening, he keeps his promises. Mm-hmm. It may have been 70 years, but guess who didn't forget about them in Babylon? You know what I'm saying? And I'm also, so like, one of the things that I'm always doing is buying a new Bible reading plan, because I always feel like this is going to be the one that helps me get. So I just bought another one recently. So I'm in Genesis again for probably the 16th time. Like, that is one, the first couple chapters of Genesis I'm well versed in.
Right.
I just keep reading them again and again. So I bought it. Did I tell you I bought a new reading plan? I did. And so I'm in Genesis again for probably the 20th time reading about Noah and the flood. But I realized, like, one of the things is that it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. And I was trying to imagine, like, what it must have been like to be in that ark. And it's like, I mean, it's just y'all and water for as far as you can see. And I was wondering, like, what they must have been thinking and what they must have been feeling. And I bet, like, I was thinking, if I was Noah anyways, on day 37, I would have been like, he forgot about us. He forgot about it. We're going to die in this boat. But I think it said God remembered Noah. And he like, some wind came or something like that. And basically, he brought an end to the rain. And it's like, no matter how much it seems like it's raining, and you're on day 38, and you're like, we are going to die in this boat, you have to remember that God is going to remember you. It is not our faithfulness. He doesn't think like we do. We're fickle people. We change our mind. We're wishy-washy. Some of us, me, are temperamental. But God is not like us. And so he's going to remember his promises, and he will do what he said he's going to do. And he does have a hope and a future for us, good plans, welfare, good things for us, not evil, because that's just the good and faithful God that we serve. So
it is. And we've talked about several times, too, if you forget how true all the things Ashley just said were, look back to your life and see some of those, because we feel it when we're in the place of looking at the future, stressing about decisions. Decisions are stressful, right? Yeah, what do I want to be when I grow up? What do I want to go to school for? Yeah, should I take this job, leave a job that I'm at that's safe and stable for the unknown? And those decisions are really weighty and stressful. And so, and this is easier said than done, but looking back and saying, well, look at all the other times, all the other decisions I'm on the other side of, and look at the areas that God worked it out, mm-hmm. right? He always does. So that gives you a little bit of a peace and helps make it easier not to worry so much about the future. Mm-hmm. And two, when you're worrying about the future, it leads a lot of times to what we call vain imaginations, right? Where you're drafting up like worst scenario type things, right? And sometimes I find myself fretting over decisions that I end up not even having to make, mm-hmm. right? You know, should I, this is, you know, we both kind of had this decision with some job things where it's like, oh, should I stay here or take this other job? And then the door slams in your face and you're like, oh, guess I didn't need to worry about that decision because it wasn't really made a decision for me to make.
Got it.
You know, or, you know, should I go this way or go that way? Well, just go, you know, go pray about it. Make your best decision and trust, because of all the things you just said about God's character, trust that he is going to redirect you if you get it wrong, right? And that's why I think we could sum up almost every episode by saying at the end, relationship with God.
Yeah.
If you worry about nothing else and you just worry about your relationship with God, getting in the God of the universe. Oh. Cammy liked it. We have a dog in the studio today.
Yeah, Cammy in the house. Yeah.
But if you just worry about your relationship with the one true God, then everything else falls into place, right? And you can trust that if you mess it up, if you go the wrong way, he loves you enough mm-hmm. that you're going to hear him say, no, we should have actually gone back the other direction. And he'll reroute you and he'll put more things in your path, and he'll slam a door in your face if he needs to.
And I'm learning that the doors that were slammed in my face, and I was so happy. I was like, I think my finger got caught a little bit in the door when it shut, because I was pulling my way through. But anyways, like, they're for a reason, and it's just maybe the timing, or maybe that particular thing wasn't for you. But like, whatever is after that door, whatever door opens next, it'll be better, and you'll be like, oh, thank you for shutting that door, God. Like, mm-hmm. that wasn't even for me. Appreciate you. Joyce Myers, you were talking about putting your foot in the water and all of that. Do you remember?
Yes. When she was talking about that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I was trying to give some context to that, because that was really good. And then I still have those CDs. I did not forget.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I did forget, but I remembered. Yes, months ago, probably a year ago. I do still have them for you today. But she was talking about how, okay, this was a while ago. I remember this.
Yeah, if you're trying to go follow God's will and you're not sure if it's this or that.
I think she gave the example first of when Moses and the Israelites were leaving Egypt, and God parted the sea so that they could go through. And he did, and they went through, and then he closed the seas and it swallowed up the Egyptians trying to like chase after them and get them. But I think the second time when they were crossing a river to get to the promised land, they had to put their foot in the water first, and then God parted the sea. Yeah. And so sometimes God does things and he opens doors to like reveal himself to us to prove that he is trustworthy, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's why he was like, I'm going to go before you. And he opened up the waters and they passed through. But this time it was like, okay, do you trust me? And so they had to go forth first and put their foot in the water before he opened the way, before he parted the seas for them to go through. And so it's like, maybe God's, this is something that I ask myself, and you have to ask God for yourself. But sometimes I'm like, God, am I waiting on you, or are you waiting on me? Did you tell me to do something, and because of fear, because of doubt, because of XYZ, I haven't done it yet? And it's like, sometimes I just have to ask myself that question. Is he waiting on me to do something? And is there something like fear or doubt or worry or whatever holding me back? Sorry, that came to mind when you were talking about that.
Yeah, and on that same line too, two things. Pastor Corey had mentioned in a recent sermon at ECC, had mentioned about if you're not sure which door God's calling you to go through, wiggle the door handle. And if it doesn't open, you know, it wasn't for you.
Right.
But even if you were to open it, start to walk through and then look around and be like, oh, this was the wrong door. God will help you get out of that. Yeah. Like, he's not going to set you up to fail. And even if you do fail a little bit, he'll grow you and you'll learn from it and you'll come out better because of those failures. So it's okay. And then also, especially when you have like a full blown encounter with the Lord and you feel how real his presence and his power is, sometimes that can almost lead you to a fear that's rooted in a fear and respect of the Lord, but it can sometimes almost make you a passive Christian because you're going to say, well, I know that God has plans. I don't want to mess it up. So I'm going to sit here and I'm not going to move until I hear the voice of God say, Jen, go do this, right? And he doesn't want that either. Yeah. He wants a partnership with us. Right. So if you have a big decision in front of you or you feel something spurring up and you're like, I think God's asking me to move away, but you're not sure, don't just sit there with your feet in the mud saying, I'm not moving until I see it written in the sky. Mm-hmm. Start to take some steps forward and trust that God loves you enough to redirect you if you didn't hear it right, right? Don't be passive because it is a partnership. So that goes back to what you said. Is he waiting on me or am I waiting on him?
Yeah.
Sometimes he does want you to start moving and then he'll make it clear after you've taken that first trust step. It really is like the trust fall, right? If he's saying, I want you to move and you're saying where, he's saying, just move. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that does feel like a trust fall and you're like, I don't know what direction he's calling me to go, but I'm going to start going. I'm going to jiggle this door handle. I'm going to dip my toe in the water and I'm going to trust that he will put some clarity to this path one way or the other.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I was just thinking, because that can be so scary. Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh.
And sometimes you'll fall.
Yeah. Sometimes you will. Sometimes maybe you go the wrong way. But like you said, he will call you back. And I think that goes to maybe just every day saying, okay, Lord, like lead me by your spirit according to your will and guide my steps, you know? And if you say that and you mean it in your heart, like he will do that and you'll be okay.
And you can even be more assured in that from a relationship with him, right? Prayer, like you just said, is part of it. Reading the word.
So important.
I mean, we could say that 100 times and it wouldn't be enough times because it's something that I think I neglected for a really long time. Even when I was really trying to walk with the Lord, I don't like to read. Mm-hmm. I still had a hard time reading the word, but it's easier for you to understand what the Holy Spirit is trying to communicate to you if you know what the truth is. It's easier not to be deceived by the lies from the enemy. I think the best analogy I heard of it was, I think it was maybe Bill Johnson was doing a sermon on it, and he said, the Holy Spirit is like the surgeon. The Word of God is like the scalpel that the surgeon's asking for. And so if you're trying to listen to the Holy Spirit and say, are we going left or right? And he's saying, scalpel. Scalpel, and you don't know not that you have to have it all memorized, it's a pretty big book, but if you don't have some of that scripture fresh on your heart, the Holy Spirit can pull it out of you, even if you don't have it all memorized. If you've laid eyes on some scripture, the Holy Spirit can say scalpel, and you can be like, oh, I remember Jeremiah 29:11. Yeah. He does have good plans for me. So even though this situation's crummy, I know that there is a hope for the future, because I know that scripture is in me, and it's easier for me to hand that scalpel over to the Holy Spirit to guide us.
Yeah, I love that. Very good.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's all we got. Trust in the Lord. He is sovereign. He is sovereign over it all. And he does have good plans for you. Just take a chill pill and know that he does have good plans for you. Remember who your father is and remember how much he loves you. And even though that doesn't make it always easy not to be anxious and worried about the future, if you really stop and just reflect on this passage of scripture, there's peace on the other side of that. Right. There's peace in knowing that he has good plans for you. And if it's not over, or if it's not good, it's not over.
Right?
What's the one I always point to you for that I love?
He who started a good work in you will see it through to completion until the day of Christ Jesus.
That's it. So don't worry. if it's not good yet, he's still working. He hasn't left you. He won't forsake you. He is still in it to win it. He's working behind the scenes. He's in it to win it. He's working behind the scenes. So I hope y'all found some comfort in this. If this encouraged you, share it with a friend. Yes. You know, it is amazing to see the impact that God can have for his kingdom with little. It can be a divine appointment, sending something. I do that to you all the time. Yeah. I'll send you something and you'll be like, wow, that video really impacted me. God can do that. He can use the words that we say. He can use the messages that you send a friend. He can use all of that because he is sovereign. So share this with somebody that you think needs to be reminded about the Lord's sovereign hand on something. Yes. Subscribe to the channel, give it a like, do all the things so that we can really help to share some of the goodness of God.
Yeah, we love you guys.
That's it. We'll see y'all next time. Thanks for listening to the Genergy for Life podcast. I hope you felt inspired to grow deeper in your relationship with God today. Be sure to like, follow, comment, subscribe, and leave us a 5-star review. Share it with a friend who can also be inspired. We'll see you next time.